Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Galaxy Man by Mark Wayne McGinnis. Narrated by James Patrick Cronin. Preface. March 2117. Alpha Centauri. Lorianne B. Commuter Station, 9552. John Gallic was the last one to hurry into the departing commuter shuttle before the outer doors quietly swooshed together. The old silver-haired steward irritably rammed the security latch into place. He gave Gallic a wary look. "This is the last time I'll hold up departure for you, John. I don't care that you're a cop."
"Understood. Won't happen again."
The steward had to crane his neck somewhat to look up at him.
"You'll find an empty seat back in aisle Y4, he said, pointing aft.
"Thanks, Max,"
Gallic said, still catching his breath and moving along the packed-in rows of commuter passengers. Midway down the aisle, Gallic wedged himself into the only seat still available, between a middle-aged woman reading a chest-high projected novel and a construction worker still wearing his hard hat and smelling of sawdust and sour body odor. Both the woman and the construction worker had to shift in their seats to make room for Gallic's not insubstantial frame. He checked the time on his wrist. Midnight. He'd barely made the last shuttle heading back to the Sol system tonight. He relaxed into the seat, exhaustion beginning to engulf him.
"Something has to change," he thought.
His impossible schedule was screwing up every relationship in his life. The weekly 5 days on, 2 days off bullshit had been going on for the better part of 2 years now. Gallic knew it wasn't only affecting him. Portsmouth, Sutherland, Stone, all DIs were on the same rigorous departmental merry-go-round. For Stone, it had led to a divorce 6 months ago. Poor guy was still a soppy mess. Reeked of desperation, always lurking around the station, no life. Gallic didn't want that. He'd rather quit than face that wrecking ball. His thoughts turned to Claire. Was she too ready to tell him to shove off? Had she had enough of this absentee husband bullshit? One who, even when he was around, was so mentally and emotionally spent, he seemed simply to be going through the motions, acting the part of the normal, devoted husband and attentive father, while in reality felt more akin to a jacked-around robot on autopilot. Christ. Who in their right mind would want to marry a detective chief inspector? Worse, one who worked 3.5 light years away from Earth. But he knew the answer. Claire would. And she'd never complained, not once. The thought made him smile. And then there was Mandy, 3 years old, going on 30. Hey, never experiencing a different type lifestyle, she probably figured all daddies were gone half the time. That was one plus. Right? Somewhere, behind and below him, the shuttle's big engines stuttered, then fully caught and then engaged. Already moving off into deep space, he knew well it would take about 8 hours before they'd hit Sol system, get into Earth's upper orbit. He needed to grab a few hours of sleep first, before reviewing several case files. He purposely avoided thinking about his numerous unsolves. 2 murders, 3 missing persons that were undoubtedly murders, plus some cold cases he also should be attending to, but didn't have the resources for. For now, though, rest. He loosened his tie and unfastened the top button of his shirt. He closed his eyes and thought about Mandy. She wanted a puppy. Was she ready for that kind of responsibility? Was he? Before an answer could present itself, sleep washed over him. 6 hours and 10 minutes later, his arm began to vibrate. Rousted from sleep, Gallic glanced down at his wrist, at his comms band. Blurry-eyed and groggy, it took him a moment to comprehend what was being projected. The repeating, flashing blue words there before him. Emergency alert, home breach. Emergency alert, home breach. Emergency alert, home breach. Gallic sat up in his seat and tapped at the communications device. He said, "Call home," in a constricted voice that sounded like it belonged to someone else. Instantly, the comms band displayed the projected words, "Calling home." He barely registered the startled sideways glances from both the construction worker and the book-reading lady sitting alongside him.
Gallic's full attention was focused on listening to Claire's unanswered comms band, which continued to ring. "Come on, answer the damn thing," he said, speaking loud enough for other commuters in the periphery around him to take notice. He heard a decisive click, then Claire's voice, screaming something, but he could only catch the last part of it.
"In the house? Oh my God! Oh my God! John!"
Gallic, up on his feet now, yelled back just as loudly, "Who's there, Claire? Who's in the house? Tell me what's happening! What's going on?" All those in the shuttle compartment had turned toward him now, staring at him, fear mirrored across each face.
"Broken into the back of the house,"
Claire said. He heard her quick breaths and the soft echoes of socked feet running. He heard, too, the old grandfather clock chiming away in the background. They were in the downstairs hallway, probably coming out from the family room, going into the front foyer. Claire said,
"Shh, take my hand, sweetie. Hurry."
She was shushing Mandy. He heard them padding up the stairs. Gallic's heart was in his throat. He looked around the confined shuttle, millions of miles away from where he needed to be.
"What's he doing here, Mommy?"
"I don't know, baby."
The old steward, Max, was rushing down the aisle toward Gallic on spindly legs, motioning for those who had also risen to their feet to sit back down. He glanced at Gallic with some trepidation. "You must take your seat while... Claire, lock yourself in your bedroom. I'm calling the local police. Stay on the line. Do you hear me?"
"Yes,"
she whispered. He heard the desperation in her voice.
"Hurry, John. Oh, God. I think he's coming."
Gallic thought he heard distant, heavy footfalls coming up the stairs. Chapter 1. July 2120. Frontier Planet, Muleshoe. 3 years and 4 months later. Gallic was in a particularly surly mood. Not about anything in particular, but then it never was. Another year had come and gone, another year spent without his wife and child. He squinted into the buffeting wind. Constant gusts that were heavy with fine, gritty particles, soil pulled up from hundreds of miles of open plains. He pulled the collar of his leather coating closer around his neck. A gamey smell of livestock and manure, and also hay and other aromas he wasn't so sure about, permeated his nostrils. Gazing off to his left, into the Cimmerian veil of purples and pinks, he noted groupings of cattle, mere blots on the landscape at this late hour and from such a long distance away. Muleshoe was a relatively small planet, colonized 27 years earlier for one intended purpose, producing beef. Hundreds of thousands of pounds of beef annually. John Gallic appreciated the sight, even the odors. Familiar sights and smells that were, some 20 years in the past, now removed from Earth's slowly repairing eco-environ. Gallic was running late. Being late adversely affected his earnings, something he couldn't let happen. Not with what was at stake. He mentally calculated how quickly he could grab the vehicle, load it into the Hound, and be back up in space. It's going to be tight. He thought about the irony. Here he was, about to repo a guy's high-end spacecraft for delinquency, when he was 2 months late making his own payments on the Hound. Up ahead, partially obscured within the churning sand cloud, he saw neon-colored lights. Muted reds, blues, and greens, plus multi-variations of those. The wind had picked up noticeably since he'd left his ship. Ignoring it, he fixed his attention on the suspended sign, hanging off angle 30 feet above the bar. The name on the sign, Renegade's Haven, blinked on and off. A staccato rhythm meant to attract visitors from miles away. For Gallic, it induced no reaction at all. He approached the front of the bar where he heard loud music escaping out through the rundown establishment's countless open gaps. Between old and bowed timber planks and from three small, ill-fitting, grease-smeared windows. The front door, though faded red with time, was a sturdy, stout affair, now wedged, partially closed against the pounding wind by what looked to be an old cast-iron anvil. Seeing the parking lot completely full, the place must be hopping, he figured. Gallic surveyed the lot. More than a few of the closer-in vehicles were open-bed hovercrafts, holding long-handled tools strewn atop errant scatterings of dirt and straw. The vehicles,
most likely owned by local field hands who worked hard doing whatever needed doing, perhaps helping to move herds from one location to another or delivering bales of hay, or escorting cattle to a sectioned-off area where they'd be put down, then readied for processing. Although Gallic didn't know much about either cattle or ranching, he did know a good deal about other things, such as determining the origins of physical or trace evidence at a homicide scene, or the best methods to use when interviewing a potential witness, or guesstimating the caliber of a bullet while studying an entry wound in the middle of a Vic's forehead. But none of those capabilities would be needed for tonight's gig. Gallic walked between various sized spacecraft, the ones parked farther out in the lot. Though some were small and some large, there were certain similarities between them, and even while some were older, looking ready to be replaced, others looked brand new and expensive, right off the dealer's lot. Here were the personal spacecrafts of wealthy businessmen, wealthy ranch owners, or their sons and daughters. Most of the vessels possessed approximately 800 to 1,200 cubic feet of inside volume capacity, perhaps about the size of an old school bus during the turn of the 21st century on Earth. But any similarity stopped there. Here were sleek, precision-made spacecraft. Most had exotic matter drives capable of FTL, as well as being integrated with the latest highly complex AI brains. Undoubtedly, these designer rides were too smart for their own good, and definitely far too smart for their current owners. At high, present-day costs, each individual ship, Gallic guessed, could be worth a cool $500 million. Maybe more. Gazing across the nearly full landing lot, in front of Renegade's Haven, he knew he was looking at, with the ever-increasing high rate of inflation, roughly $50 billion worth of fancy, high-priced space transportation. Hurrying up, it took Gallic another 5 minutes to pinpoint and find the specific craft he was searching for. One of the newer ships, a Hausenbach L-35T. Built within the German manufacturing territories, close to a light-year's distance away, across a vast open space. A fine machine, very expensive, and the owner was 3 months delinquent in making payments. Gallic, on site to repo the vehicle, mentally appraised the fine ship. It would fetch a nice percentage, perhaps even enough to get him current with the hound. As he moved around the taxium glass hull, a polished chrome appearance craft, he slid his palm across the slick surface. Both the ingress and egress for a new L-35T was completely AI-controlled. No seams, no hairline gaps, which would allow Gallic to use the tools of his trade to penetrate a hatchway. Of German design origin, the AI, probably made by Spincher and Cowell, was a crazy smart artificial intelligence unit. And, undoubtedly, it was watching him at that very moment, had already tapped into the cornet and knew who he was and what he did for a living. Also, what he'd been another lifetime ago. Because this newer breed of AI was so thorough, so tenacious, it would have, by now, delved far deeper into his past, into every aspect of his life. But Gallic didn't really care what it had uncovered. It didn't change the fact that this very vehicle needed to be loaded onto the Hound, then returned to the selling dealership, preferably tonight, tomorrow morning at the latest. He gave the craft an affectionate pat, then headed off in the direction of the blinking blue, red, and green neon lights. Time to do things the old-fashioned way, he mused. John Gallic entered the seedy watering hole through the faded red door, knowing exactly what to expect inside. He'd been there before, had conducted business there, had been there to drink and sometimes not to drink. The proprietor knew enough about him to know that disturbing him would be a bad idea. John was well aware of the impact his presence made. He looked at the tightly packed-in patrons, those who usually came and went from Renegade's Haven for the most part unnoticed. But at 6'6" and close to 240 pounds, he was an imposing figure. He pictured himself through their eyes, seeing the leather Stetson worn low over his eyes, the dark brown trousers and heavy black boots. wearing a long, well-worn leather duster, supported by shoulders that just about spanned the open door's threshold, he watched as curious eyes moved in their sockets, seeing who, or what, had so obtrusively entered their space. The music was loud, and the smoky haze from cigarettes, cigars, and a few pipes gave the place a far more mysterious ambiance than it deserved. The combined hum of chattering voices decreased several decibels as more heads turned around to face him. He continued to survey the room, taking in as much detail as he could. Good with details, he was trained to notice things the average person would disregard. Training that took place in another lifetime, when he was a different person. The DCI, the Chief Inspector for the Colonial Police, Space District 22. But that life was ancient history, one that belonged in the past. For the last 3 years, Gallic was officially known as a Territory Abettor, more commonly referred to as a Frontier Marshal. Frontier Marshals were independent contractors that provided a handful of, and not always the most respected, services. Earth's distant spatial territories, lacking much in the way of institutional policing, engaged Frontier Marshals to fill in the gap. Covering everything, especially those that had high-end stakes, like investigating murders, of which there'd been a good number, Gallic was good at closing most cases on the frontier worlds. His previous years, spent as a DCI, had come in handy. He'd built a solid reputation in the frontier worlds for being relentless, a bulldog, said to always get his man. Or woman, if that was the case. Although not 100% true, Gallic was fine with that general assumption. On the low end of marshalling, Gallic's duties included the errant breaking up of bar brawls, petty crimes, even the repossessing of spacecraft. Finding such side repo work paid surprisingly well. It also kept him busy. Too busy to think. Too busy to remember. He made his way over to the bar and squeezed between two seated, conversing elderly men. Forced off their bar stools, they grumbled something unintelligible. The pair leaned forward, peering around him, and resumed their conversation while drinking their house-brand whiskies. Gallic caught the proprietor's attention. He looked pretty much the same as the three other busy bartenders catering to needy patrons. Wearing a stained white apron, the medium-sized man with a receding hairline wiped his hands on a dish towel and made his way down the bar to where Gallic stood waiting. He asked, "Usual?" "Not tonight, Randy." Leaning forward, Gallic spoke just loud enough for him to hear. "I'm looking for a guy. Lars Coogan." The barkeep looked hesitant. "Don't bust up the place, Gallic. No trouble here tonight, okay?" "Uh-huh. Just point him out to me." The proprietor gestured with his chin toward a large group, which had pulled three tables together. An eruption of laughter followed by arms raised high, the clinking of shot glasses. A rowdy, happy group. "He's the one at the far head of the table. He's the one with that thing around his neck. Not sure what those things are called," Randy said. "It's called an ascot." "Looks pretty silly to me," Randy added. Gallic said, "Anyway, thanks. Go ahead and ping my account for a double shot. Either drink it yourself or give it away." He turned and made his way through the packed sea of patrons, needing to shuffle between chairs and tables. Several times he had to turn sideways in order to maneuver his way toward the seated, boisterous partygoers. No less than 12, they were mostly in their 20s, Gallic surmised. Dressed to the nines, designer clothes meant to impress each other and everyone else, the women were bare-shouldered, tan, and wore an abundance of conflicting, fragrant perfumes. The men, equal in number, wore suits with bolo ties and leather cowboy boots etched with elaborate design work. A lit cigarette hanging loosely from the corner of his mouth, Lars Coogan's eyes met Gallic's as he approached. Designer stubble on his face, he wore his highlighted, streaked hair parted far over on one side, his angled bangs strategically flopped over one eye. Sitting there, Gallic guessed he was about 6 feet tall. He'd soon find out. A woman's thin, tanned arm was casually draped over Lars's left shoulder, sitting close behind him and just to the side, like she'd joined the party late and had to pull a chair up from an adjoining table. Her dangling, bobbling earrings caught the light as her head turned this way and that. She wore faded, snug jeans and some kind of halter top that emphasized her breasts. All in all, though, dressed more casually than the other women there, it all worked. She was stunning. As Gallic closed in on the end of their table, a bemused smile crossed her lips. Seated to Lars's immediate left and right sides were two big barrel-chested guys. Gallic knew the type. Sure, the bulk was there, but it was comprised more from pork than any real muscle. Looking weirdly similar, even down to their shiny gray suits and abundance of wet-looking product slicking back their hair, they were two matching oversized bookends. Through narrowed eyes, they assessed Gallic and smirked. His guess? They were more like a rich boy's protection than actual friends. As Gallic leaned down to say something to their boss, they tensed, straightening up in their chairs. Lars took a pull from his cigarette and leaned forward. The girl with the bobbling earrings watched on with mild interest. Gallic said, "Hey man, you Lars?" He exhaled a cloud of smoke. "What's it to you?" "Looks like someone just backed into your ride. Hurry, and you can catch the son of a bitch. Probably still out there in the lot." Lars stared up at him, then over to the bookends who Gallic had mentally assigned the names Tweedledee and Tweedledum. Lars said, "Just know that if it was you, you're a dead man." Chapter 2. Frontier Planet Muleshoe, Renegade's Haven. Gallic stood aside as Lars flew from his seat, shoved past him, and headed for the exit. Looking startled, the two bookends in their shiny suits clumsily extricated their legs from beneath the table and hauled their bulks quickly between chairs and tables, disrupting customers. After knocking over someone's drink and tipping over two chairs, they were hot on the heels of Lars. "They move pretty fast for porky guys," Gallic thought. The girl with the earrings rose to her feet, giving Gallic an appraising look. She stood there for several moments with that same bemused expression. She held out her hands, palms up, in a gesture that implied, "Are you going to move out of the way?" Outside, the wind had settled down to a mild breeze. The sand cloud was moving away to the south. By the time Gallic arrived at the Hossenbach L-35T, Lars had apparently completed his circling of the ship's hull, giving her a quick look over, undoubtedly making sure there were no new dents or scratches on the vehicle's pristine finish. Seeing him approach, Lars studied Gallic from head to toe, an expression of distaste crossing his face, like he was looking at a bug, or maybe a wayward turd lying on the ground. "What the fuck's your problem, dude? There's absolutely nothing wrong with my 5T, he said, moving into Gallic's personal space. Placing his hands on his hips, cigarette still dangling there in his lips, his angry face glared up at Gallic. And there they were, Tweedledee and Tweedledum. They hovered a close step behind him, one on each side, trying to act menacing. Gallic hadn't known the proper abbreviated vernacular for Lars's ship was simply 5T. It had a nice ring to it, 5T. "Hey, it's your ride, man," Gallic said. "It's no skin off my nose if you think she's fine."
"So why don't you tell us what you think you saw?"
Gallic shrugged. "Looked like an old Buick Starflight, green, I think. It bumped your 5T down low. Over there in the front, jostling her pretty good, but hey, she's probably fine." Gallic turned as if he were going to leave, then spun back around. You did fire her up, didn't you? See that she's still operational after being slammed into like that? I'm sure I don't need to tell you, that's a fine-tuned precision craft." Lars seemed to contemplate on his suggestion for a moment. Then, turning his attention to the girl with the dangling earrings who just arrived, now standing closer to Gallic than to Lars himself, he raised his brows questioningly.
"Maybe he's right. Maybe I should at least check her out to be on the safe side. Certainly couldn't hurt, Gallic said. Lars, patting his breast suit jacket pocket, brought out a start cube and walked around the 5T to where, Gallic figured, the vessel's hidden access hatch was located. Holding the cube between two fingers, he positioned it at waist-level height against her pristine fuselage. The cube flew, disappeared into the ship as though it had melded in there. Kerr's technology. Gallic had heard about this latest application of the alien science and wondered how much extra Lars paid for such a useless option. $1 million? $2 million? Then, almost magically, the 5T's hatch began to lift up and outward, like a graceful gull wing in mid-flight. Gallic let out a breath. So easy. Having the start cube in place was exactly what he needed. The vehicle, now accessible, was also drivable, either by him or anyone else. He said, "Hey, hold up there a moment." Frowning, Lars halted, one leg poised on the first step leading into the ship. Gallic reached him in three strides, already unfolding an electronic vid sheet. Handing it to him, he said, "This authorizes me to take possession of this vehicle. I'm repossessing it. Step away from the craft. Do so now." Lars's cigarette flipped end over end from his lips and bounced off his knee. "Like hell you are," he spat. He grabbed a hold of both sides of the hatchway. "No one's taking my 5T. There has to be a mistake. I pay my fucking bills." Gallic shrugged. "Either that or your daddy does. Unfortunately, one of you has missed a few payments. 3, to be exact. You can either take care of the default at your bank or at the dealership. She'll be waiting there for you in the morning. Now move aside." Lars, hunkering down, wasn't going to make this easy. "Johnny. Donnie, don't just stand there. Take care of this guy." He sensed the two of them had moved in closer behind. He could smell their foul breath. Gallic felt a heavy palm on his right shoulder. A surprisingly high voice then said, "You're going to give Mr. Coogan a bit more time to take care of this business. If you don't, we'll hurt you. Hurt you bad. Leave you here bleeding in the dirt and gravel. You understand me? Now why don't you put that little vid sheet back in your pocket, you know, before we get angry and do something we'll laugh about later?" Gallic, not turning around, glanced at the meaty hand still resting on his shoulder. "Which one are you? Johnny or Donnie?"
"I'm Donnie,"
Gallic said over his opposite shoulder. "Johnny, best you head back into the bar. Ask for Randy."
"Yeah? What for?"
"Ask to borrow a bucket. You know, one of those big steel jobs with a metal handle." He snorted and made an irritated expression.
"What would I need with a damn bucket?"
Gallic sensed the beefy twosome were exchanging perplexed looks. "Because if your friend here doesn't take his hand off my shoulder, you'll be taking what's left of him home in it." Gallic felt Donnie's hand come off his shoulder, and he sensed Lars's bodyguard was in the process of turning his upper torso, that he was winding up to deliver a punch. Gallic didn't need to look at him to know precisely what he was going to do. The mistake most people make in this situation is to try to duck away, avoid being hit. But Gallic did the opposite. You never do what your opponent expects you to do. In this case, what Donnie would expect. Instead, he stepped back, right into him, up close and personal. When Donnie's punch came, there was no room for him to extend his arm, no way for him to put any of his porky weight in behind it. Directed at the vicinity of his kidneys, it arrived more of a love tap than a real punch. Without hesitation, Gallic, half-turning and faking a half-step forward, quickly rocked back on his heels while at the same time he ratcheted his right elbow back hard. The height differential between Gallic and Donnie couldn't have worked out any better. The familiar knob protrusion, located at the end of the elbow, is actually a part of the humerus bone. Gallic's arms were large and muscular, and the round knob at the end of his humerus was poised to act more like the business end of a sledgehammer than that inconsequential bone most people took for granted. Gallic's fast-moving elbow made contact with Donnie's nose and, in the process, totally annihilated it. In that fraction of a second, Donnie's nasal bone,
the supporting septal cartilage, as well as both sides of the maxillary bones, either splintered outright or instantly turned into something akin to toothpaste. The sudden impact was enough to bounce Donnie's brain, hard forward first, then just as hard backward, within the confined space of his oversized cranium. Suddenly unconscious, Donnie dropped like a sack of rice. Gallic next turned his attention to Johnny, holding a semi-automatic handgun in his left hand, whose attention was still focused on the bloodied heap lying at his feet. Gallic stepped forward and grabbed the gun out of his hand. Fully intending to do the same thing to Johnny that he'd just done to Donnie, the girl said,
"Stop! Just leave him alone!"
Gallic hesitated.
Looking over to Lars, she said,
"You can get the 5T back tomorrow. Let the creep take her. Lars, it's not worth it."
Lars glared at Gallic, whose expression remained impassive. Eventually, Lars stepped down from the open hatchway.
"Do you know who I am? Who my family is?"
"Nope. Can't say that I do," Gallic replied.
"You're done. I hope you've enjoyed this low-life job of yours, because you're finished. You'll be fired by morning."
Gallic, after pushing past him and stepping into the open hatchway, turned around to face the still-seething Lars Coogan. "Good luck with that. I work for myself, an arbiter. Best take care of your friend there. I'd turn him over onto his side for a while if I were you." Stepping inside the craft, he caught the girl's eye as the gullwing hatch began to close. Not quite reading her questioning expression, she said,
"You're a piece of work, you know that?"
"Yeah. Well, I've been called worse, sweetheart." The 5T's cockpit, with its myriad of glowing dials and indicators, was just as impressive inside as it was outside. A sweet, high-end spacecraft, and Lars certainly hadn't foregone adding the more luxurious options. Gallic sat down in the pilot's seat, feeling it automatically adjust to his girth. He'd never sat in anything so comfortable. Certainly a far cry from the rock-hard cushions found in the Hound. Spinning the seat around, he studied the craft's warm and inviting cabin. Padded leather was everywhere. Cushy wrap-around leather chairs and sectional couches. Inset strips of decorative wood, perhaps walnut, accented the padded interior sides and overhead bulkheads. Gallic swiveled his chair back around, ready to face the business at hand. Firing up the 5T's propulsion system, he took the controls in his hands. He activated the underbelly thrusters and lifted off. 30 feet above the landing lot, he cranked the controls hard left. Accelerating fast, he left behind Renegade's Haven, the sprawling pasture land, and the sporadic clustering of cattle. At a quarter mile out, Gallic reached into his inside coat pocket and fingered the small opener device. The rear hatch on the Hound began opening up. Light instantly peeked through the quickly expanding gap around it. He slowed the 5T's progression and waited for the hatch, doing double duty as hatch and gangway, to descend all the way to a reverse downward angle. Goosing the 5T, he piloted her directly into the Hound's hold, a hold large enough to transport several old jetliners, if the need for such a thing ever arose. It took him another 5 minutes to carefully strap down and secure the 5T onto the inside deck. Any damage incurring to the craft now would come right off the top of his repo fees. Once satisfied, he initiated the closing of the hold's rear hatch. He glanced around to ensure the handful of other vehicles in there were also strapped into place. Everything looked to be in order. By the time he crossed the hold into the entranceway of the rear airlock, he heard the familiar pressurized thunk sound as the Hound's massive back hatch seeded into the cowling surrounding it. Exiting the airlock, Gallic headed up the ship's internal stairway, which led to the second level. The top level of the Hound looked more like an open New York City loft build-out than the top deck of a working hauler-type spacecraft. 55 feet wide by 59 feet long, it seemed like one huge square. Even though the large compartment looked industrial, there was something strangely inviting about the space, nevertheless.
due perhaps to its wide-planked timber decking and the soft, indirect lighting generated from large canned lights 15 feet overhead. Also, there was a decorative intermixing of home furnishings. Colorful Navajo throw rugs draped over stuffed, worn leather couches and a set of multi-prism Tiffany lamps set on craftsman-style side tables. Long observation windows, installed on opposing bulkheads, provided scenic high-up views to the now darkening landscape below. Gallic moved swiftly across the sectionalized space to a bank of extending out forward-facing windows, where two rotating seats and a waist-level-high, semicircle-shaped console were positioned, the paint both dinged and scratched. Not fully a ship's bridge, nothing that elaborate, or a cockpit. More purposeful, it was the Hound's command center. As he approached, a projected holographic display came alive on his right. Nearly as high as himself in height, the display was in the process of updating his weekly job log. He noticed the latest repo job. Vehicle, Hossenbach L35T. Owner, Mr. Lars Coogan. Current standing, impounded, transferring. Final destination, dealer at Bantam Exotic Starcrafts. As Gallic traced with his index finger other open work repo orders, he noticed another three, which would also require his attention over the next day or two. A reminder window popped into view. You have two vid messages. Both messages are tagged high priority. Gallic, after taking a seat, addressed the Hound's AI, voicing out loud, "Go ahead, play first one." A blue-tinted, life-sized holographic image came to life. A short, bald-headed man in a wrinkled Hawaiian shirt stared at Gallic. One of Gallic's past associates, Polly Gant, a less-than-scrupulous provider of both repo and bail bondsman services that he tended to avoid unless there was absolutely no other work at hand. Polly smiled. "Hey, Galaxy Man, call me. You pick up that Hossenbach craft yet? Listen, I have a special project for you. It's perfect for someone with your unique capabilities. Time-sensitive, so don't," Gallic said. "Skip message. Go to the next." On the projected display, an older black man appeared, dressed in a smart-fitting navy blue uniform. His heavily lined face seemed more covered with age spots than Gallic remembered, and his hair, although still mostly black, looked peppered now with more white, as did his immaculately trimmed goatee. The man was Chief Superintendent Bernard Danbury, who, 3.5 years prior, was his boss, friend, and mentor. Gallic resisted the oncoming flood of memories, like snakes trying to twist and wiggle their way into his consciousness. Danbury said, "Hello, John. I hope this message finds you in good health." "Pause message," Gallic commanded the AI. He stared at the frozen-in-time holographic image. He'd worked for the superintendent for close to a decade, rising quickly within the Territorial Police Department, Spatial District 22. On becoming DCI Chief Inspector, he reported directly to him. He left the position soon after the murders never solved, which he had not been allowed to have any involvement with. John closed his eyes, fighting to keep the ever-intruding vermin at bay. Nothing held more importance for him than finding the person responsible for the murders of the young and beautiful 31-year-old woman and her equally beautiful 3-year-old daughter, John Gallic's wife and little girl. His old life as he knew it ended the day the two were taken from him. Now he merely survived, though he continued to follow up on what he wasn't permitted to do as DCI for the Territorial Police Department, Spatial District 22. Since he was both the husband and father of the homicide victims, he wasn't allowed to have direct involvement in the case. Deemed a serious conflict of interest. Something the lead investigator, Freddie McDonald, was all too happy to enforce. There had already been bad blood between the two for years. Gallic, younger and newer to the department, had quickly moved up in the ranks to the coveted Detective Chief Inspector, DCI, position above McDonald. He hadn't taken it well. As the lead investigator of the case, McDonald stonewalled him, restricting any further access to the case files. Gallic and MacDonald fought continuously. Blows were exchanged. The grisly crime was front-page news for weeks as the investigation proceeded in earnest. His disputes with MacDonald aside, Gallic knew everyone involved in the case had good intentions. Three full-time investigators were assigned, each working hard and piling on the OT. But encouraging leads eventually hit a dead end. As the promising prospects dried up, official personnel plus other resources were assigned to new active cases. Other crimes now captured the media's headlines. But that didn't halt Gallic's off-time pursuit. For months, his friend, Chief Superintendent Bernard Danbury, turned a blind eye to Gallic's growing number of sick days off. Days spent in his private crusade to find the killer, or killers, of Claire and Mandy. Ultimately, he was forced to resign, which was for the best. Now, some 3+ years later, Gallic, during his off time, continued the pursuit, seeking to find the one who'd ruined everything, who had stolen away his life. The life insurance policy hadn't provided much, but he had some savings. Financing a high-interest loan, he purchased a wrecked Hewley Jawbone Carrier for pennies on the dollar. The Hound. It took him over a year to make the craft spaceworthy. With the snakes now held somewhat at bay, Gallic said, "Continue the message." "John, I wanted to be the first one to tell you there's been a development in your wife and daughter's case. We may have a strong lead." Chapter 3. Frontier Planet, Gorman, Heritage Plains Township. His actions were unhurried, almost methodical in nature, well practiced. He moved within the home's darkness silently, like a whisper or a slight breeze, a breath. He stopped and listened to the sounds, louder now, emanating from the family room. The killer tilted his head, not wanting to miss a thing. How he'd missed this. There was a short giggle, really more of a snort, from the young girl, Tammy. He smiled. What a lovely sound that was. He needed to remember it, mentally catalog it away for later, for forever. The sound of playing cards being shuffled echoed into the hallway where he stood.
"Oh, no you don't, you little cheater," the mother exclaimed, laughing.
Ah, that would be Catherine. The killer took a step, then another. He wasn't concerned about being discovered within the home. They were alone here. Only the three of them now. He'd made certain of that. He took another step, this one quicker, more deliberate. A rustling sound was suddenly more audible, his hard leather belt rubbing against the fabric of his disposable overalls, also a jingly sound as small nails collided within his oversized pouch. His eyes fell to the tool belt, secured across his narrow hips. Glaring down at it, he listened, hearing only silence. But then came their soft whispering.
"Did you hear that?"
"Did I hear what?" the mother replied, her voice playful.
"I'm serious,"
came the young girl's excited whisper.
"Your turn to deal. I'm getting up to pee. Want anything from the fridge?"
the mother asked, continuing the whisper game as she moved into the kitchen. Right then, the killer shot forward into the kitchen, a mere blur of motion and wild kinetic energy. He spun, reached out for Catherine's long hair, and felt its softness, its slippery nature in his palm, trapped now within his fingers. Tightening his grip, he tugged hard. Jerked backwards, Catherine's scream was cut short by an uncontrolled inhalation of breath. As she toppled over, the killer dragged her, caveman style, as she kicked and flailed about. Together, they moved out from the kitchen into the family room. Rising to her feet, Tammy's mouth gaped open, her eyes wide, not understanding.
"You!"
Catherine yelled, kicking out and connecting a solid, painful blow to his upper thigh. The killer released his hold on the woman's hair and spun, punching out with fury to the side of her head, a punch that contained sufficient force to crack concrete. More than enough force to crack the side of her skull. He glanced up, noting the pretty daughter's horrified face. She wants to run. Instead, though, Tammy lost control of her bladder. The killer fondled the handle of the 10-inch knife at his hip, next to the head of the ball-peen hammer.
"Please don't hurt."
Tammy's eyes followed the motion of his fast-moving hand, the knife's sideways trajectory, and moved to cover her throat. But she was too slow. Chapter 4. Frontier Planet, Muleshoe. Gallic didn't move, simply stared at the blank display and the hovering end-of-vid message prompt. AI, request a real-time channel to Superintendent Bernard Danbury at D-22. Let me know when you have a connection. Gallic knew the request for an encoded synchronous comms channel could take anywhere from 10 minutes to several hours, sometimes longer. He headed toward the loft's port side while removing his outer coat, draping it over the back of one of the leather couches. He entered into the cooking mess area, located at the rear far side of the compartment. Pulling out three separate frying pans from the low-placed cupboards, he set them on the cooktop while willing his mind into submission. One by one, mentally closing all inner doors and windows and locking them shut, he then rechecked each one again, battening down the hatches. He'd practiced this same mental exercise 1,000 times, maybe 10,000 times. For the most part, it worked. He managed to stay in control, keeping the wiggly things from slithering in, infiltrating his thoughts. He opened the refrigerator and retrieved a nearly full carton of large brown chicken eggs and placed them on the steel-top counter. Using his shoulder to prop open the door, he next grabbed a glass pitcher filled with fresh milk, a stick of butter, and a generous slab of uncut bacon, setting each down by the carton of eggs. Next, Gallic opened the top cupboard where he retrieved a loaf of unsliced sourdough bread. Firing up 3 burners, he adjusted the flames before adding ample pats of butter to 2 of the pans. The butter quickly sizzled down, its oily liquid coating the bottom of the pans. As he jostled the pans around, the clang of metal clanging into metal was both a familiar and welcome sound, grounding him, keeping him present. Pulling a long knife from a drawer, he quickly sliced through the slab of bacon. Hungry, he cut the slabs thick and placed them into the ungreased, heated pan, which began to sizzle. Making 4 wide cuts in the loaf of sourdough, he situated the slices 1 at a time in the larger buttered pan. 1 by 1, he cracked open 7 eggshells, letting their contents slurp into a large red bowl. Pouring in 7 generous drips of milk, he rapidly beat the mixture with a fork to ensure enough air was swirled into the eggy mixture. Sufficiently beaten, he poured the contents into the other buttered pan. Using a fork to turn the bacon and flip over the slices of bread, he suddenly had to squeeze shut his eyelids. Without warning, a mental door had cracked open, standing ajar. Gallic caught movement there in the semi-blackness, lying just beyond his closed, tight lids. The paralysis came first. He heard them approaching. A muffled, awful sound, like a stampede of oversized vermin. As the bacon began to burn, the eggs thickening, then scorching, greasy smoke rose into the compartment's air and swirled around him. Gallic continued viewing the ever-widening inner door where, in the near darkness and obscured by the billowing smoke, he saw the small, reptilian, non-human faces. Clamoring to get out, fighting one another, each wanting to be the first to come forth. But suddenly, in an instant, he was no longer peering inward into an open doorway or concerned with crawly snakes or even aware a fire had started on the stovetop. His entire attention was transported to another time, where, centered on his scratched, weathered D-22 desk, was an open case file. More precisely, a crime scene case file. He reached for the stack of 8x10 vid sheets. Hot bile crept into his throat. His heart rate jumped, becoming almost tachycardic as their distorted, bloated faces, blurry at first, came into view.
"Fire! Mr. Gallic! Fire! Fire! Mr. Gallic! Fire!"
Gallic's focus returned from the past, from 3 years, 4 months, and 13 days ago. He turned off the burners and stacked the 3 blisteringly hot pans into the sink. Flames erupted momentarily when bacon grease sloshed onto what remained of the ruined toast. AI, increase mess area ventilation until this damn smoke clears.
Yes, sir. Your requested comms channel has been re-established, and Chief Superintendent Bernard Danbury is waiting for you.
Gallic walked from the cooking mess area toward the control center, his heart rate still accelerated, not yet a normal beat. Cursing under his breath, he was irritated with himself. He'd obviously forgotten to properly latch and lock up an inner door inside his screwed-up mind. He had to be much more careful in the future. The holographic image of Superintendent Bernard Danbury was waiting for Gallic. With concern furrowing his brow, Danbury asked, "Did I hear something about a fire?" "Nah, everything's fine. The Hound's AI can be a bit dramatic." "How are you, John?" "Fine, right as rain." "You're still working?" the older man asked. "What else am I going to do? Plant tulips back on Earth?" Gallic quickly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.